Listening Library presents This Full House by Virginia Euwer Wolff. Read for you by Heather Alicia Sims. Part 1. Chapter 1. I could not have known, would never have predicted, as if I had been a leaf floating in a gutter toward the sea, or a puff of dust blowing through an open window. That was how much I knew about how this would all happen, how we would all end up. No more than that. Chapter 2. Jilly and Jeremy come scurrying from the swings, scuttling up little whirls of dirt, hopping and smiling, such energy of pep and joy, and it's only a bag two-thirds full of popcorn I'm holding open in my hand. Jeremy is transformed into a big kindergarten boy, consuming books so fast he has to read them over and over before Jolly can take him back to the library between her school and work hours. Jolly, who did not have such a thing as a library card till this amazing boy turned out to be such a bookish child, and who also appears to be Batman at times, as well as other flying people. Jilly herself is nearly 4, friendly as always. She likes to play cards because the king and queen and their jokester amuse her. She imitates their faces and waits till we notice before she puts her own face back on. Jolly goes to school to get her GED. Jeremy prints huge words in kindergarten, like catfish and frog and pocket, way oversized in his nearsighted vision. And Jilly makes blobs of clay into different blobs of clay, bending over her work like a sculptor in Head Start, so she will have a head start. She is in the same building I was, back when Myrtle and Annie and I were so little, and the teachers nailed our coat hooks on the wall, down where my knees are now. Those same coat hooks are still there. Jilly's coat goes where Annie's little red one used to hang. I would recognize that red a block away, as I used to. Annie coming along, skipping on squares, avoiding the cracks in the sidewalk, jouncing her mama's arm till it would nearly fall off, her mama said. And I believed her. I told my mom, Annie's mama's arm gonna fall off. And my mom told me that was plain foolishness. No small child could break off a part of a mother. I was finding out how moms are indestructible. And sometimes I think my mom is the only one who still is. Jilly leaps into the classroom in the morning, scoops sand at the sand table, pouring it back and forth, paints big pink and yellow paintings at the easel, loves to sit on teachers' laps. This little one, who wouldn't have been born if boys had been nice to Jolly, and who would be dead now if Jolly had not blown life back into her. This child can give champion hugs and go in the potty like a big girl. She sleeps with a book, lying on top of it. Sometimes it's a book about scooters. Sometimes it's Goodnight Moon. And she recites them at any time of day. Jilly runs to me in this shiny afternoon with her arms outstretched and Jeremy is planted in front of me, the giant at the top of the beanstalk. He scares us with fee, fi, fo, fum in his small child roar and reaches his giant hand into the bag for popcorn. Jilly noses the bag, chirping, tweet, tweet. Her nose a beak, her eyes bird's eyes. Tree branches weave waves of light on their faces. We leave the playground, hand in hand in hand, skipping, loping, galumphing, being rabbits and giraffes and hippos. And by the time we get to Jolly's house, I am ready to drop. Chapter 3. Jolly made soup. She soaked the beans, boiled a chicken for broth. She sliced up carrots, celery, started at the top of the onion, leaving the root end for last in order to cut it without crying. She tore the slippery chicken meat off the bones and slid the pieces into the pot that Ricky brought home from the Goodwill. She remembered to keep the heat on low so the soup wouldn't burn. I watched her stirring it all together, doing this task that she never did before. In her whole congested apartment, the air steamed with vegetables, drawers were not hanging open, chairs were right side up, waiting. Such a thing as making soup. Not once did she threaten to quit in the middle, as I have seen her do with other things. Jeremy helped set the table, putting out spoons for everyone. I tore paper towels from the roll, and he put one on the table for each of us five, with Ricky home in time for supper. Jilly and I had a hairbrush situation when she started to pick up Jolly's private, personal hairbrush, and don't you ever forget it. I shooshed Jilly away and stared her toward her own. I whispered to her how she always has to use her own brush, which she already knew, of course. She sparkled her eyes up at me, this huggable child. Everybody ate up this good soup, Jilly slopping it in front and to the side and saying,
"Jeremy says octopus got no bones,"
looking around to see if we will help her catch Jeremy being wrong. Ricky says,
"He's right, Jilly. Remember the aquarium? The octopus goes all squished. He couldn't do that if he had bones."
Jeremy counts the pieces in his bowl and reports to his mother.
"There's 2 carrots and 4 green things, 5, 6, 7 brown pieces, and slippy ones, and 2 chickens."
This is Jolly, who got so thrown down in her poor life, and nobody saved her, so she is figuring out how to save herself.
"You keep on with school, you'll learn things too, like Mommy learned to make soup,"
says Ricky down to Jeremy, who concentrates on him from inside his new glasses with doggies on their frames. A child in kindergarten fell down on his other ones. Jeremy is such a good sport about wearing his thick glasses. He has worn them since he was not yet even 3. Everyone in this room goes to school, even Ricky, who got accepted for firefighter training, which makes Jeremy worship him. Jeremy sings,
"I'm a fireman fighter with my own boots on. They got handles to put on with. They got handles to put on with."
Jolly, who says she never had any folks at all, a throwaway child, who won't even answer questions about when she was little. Now her own son is in kindergarten, and he can read and count. He keeps a total of cockroaches he sees in a day. Then he starts over again the next morning. Sometimes when we meet, he shouts,
14, LaVaughn!
And Ricky has not left Jolly yet. The only one who didn't, I guess. Once when Jolly got storming mad at everything, she hollered,
"Why don't you just go? Everybody else done that. How come you ain't left yet?"
And Ricky said back to her,
"It wouldn't be the right thing to do."
Jolly asked me,
"LaVaughn, you ever think any guy ever said to me about the right thing to do before in my life? Never. Not ever. Not one. Not till Ricky." I keep wondering how all this can be, and I want to sing out,
"Hey, everybody, look at Jolly. Look how she does her life. Could you do that?" Instead, I tell her in a blunt, unimportant voice, "This soup is excellent, Jolly. You're good." She looks at me, her eyes coming from underneath and sideways, admitting and yet not admitting that she's good. And I could jump with happiness. I do not. I eat a second bowl of soup and listen to Jilly telling me about the world.
"Octopus got no bones," says Jilly.
A piece of celery tips off her spoon onto my arm.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.